about the history of the Chicano movement. And then about two-thirds of the way through that lecture, we're going to watch a documentary that's in two parts, about a half an hour or so total, about the moratorium march. And then we're going to go back and finish off the history and start talking about some of the critiques from the authors. Anybody have any questions or concerns or bureaucratic issues or anything before I get started? So the first part of this lecture also comes from the same book that I assigned for from Ian Haney Lopez. The title of the book is Racism on Trial. It was published in 2003 or something like that. Ian Haney Lopez is a law professor, or I'm not sure if he's still there, but I assume at the law school at UC Berkeley. And so he wrote this book about the Chicano movement and about the legal strategies and the legal fallout of what happened. And also he concludes with a critique of Chicano nationalism, which is what I assigned for you to read. So I'm going to give you the history from some of the earlier chapters that you didn't read for today, so you kind of have the historical foundation and background to make sense of the critiques as we move into them. So we're going to start our discussion in late 1967, when students in East Los Angeles and Mexican students at different colleges in the Los Angeles region started to organize themselves and started to think about, you know, how they could resist the circumstances that they faced at school and also in the community. With blatantly, you know, this is the 60s, of course, blatantly racist teachers and police, teachers at school and police on the streets. One of the, you know, the organization that you're probably most familiar with is, of course, the Brown Beret, right, which we still have kind of a Brown Beret, you know, chapter, quasi-chapter active in East LA today. But the real Brown Berets, the original Brown Berets, were mostly college students and a few veterans, primarily from the East Side. But there was another organization that was really important for the walkouts and the moratorium movement and the Chicano movement more generally, and that's UMass, United Mexican American Students, which was founded in the mid to late, I think it's 66 or 67, and was basically, you know, today we have Mecha on campus, right, which is a group for Chicano students, right, and so at that time they started this idea that the Mexican students at different colleges should, you know, form an organization and have chapters on the different campuses and stuff, and so UMass is what that was. Many of the UMass student activists were, you know, had close connections to the Brown Berets, and, you know, it's all of these people know each other, right? So there's these kind of different groups. And the thing to think about UMass and some of the many of the Brown Berets as well is that they were much older, right? They were, most of them were in their 20s and were in college. Some of the Brown Berets were even in their 30s, and there was, I think, a couple of them that were in their early 40s, one or two that were in their early 40s. Whereas the walkouts, of course, was primarily high school kids. And so when, and also there's, you know, just like anybody grows up in East LA, you know, there's a lot of family connections too. An older brother or sister might be in college, and a younger brother or sister might be, you know, a student at Garfield or Lincoln or Wilson or wherever, right? So in fall of 1967, students at high schools in East LA, under the influence and with the help of an organizing help of UMass students from local colleges and the involvement of the Brown Berets as well, started talking about organizing some type of direct action, in primarily in the form of a walkout. They didn't take any action that fall that year, but there was a lot of discussion about it and organizing. And a student at Lincoln, which at that time was the, I don't know if this is still true, that time was the most run down, you know, decrepit high school in East LA. The teacher's name was Sal Castro. He was one of the few Mexican teachers in LA Unified at that time. You know, even in East LA, I don't know if any of you, I assume at least a few of you may have grown up in East LA, and probably most of your teachers today are also Mexican, Chicano, Mexican American, whatever you want to call it. But back then it was, you know, very, very rare. Most teachers were Anglos, and very WASPy at that. And so Sal Castro, you know, had a close relationship with the students, and he kind of served as a mentor. And he encouraged them to, you know, to think about what they want to do and make a good plan and organize across the different schools and, you know, to put their plan into action. And so in the spring semester in 1968, they were making these plans to have to stage a walkout across the whole East Side that would also be connected to the local city colleges. And so Cal State campus, you know, our campus, of course, and so forth. However, their plans were preempted when the principal at Wilson pulled a jerk move on the students and canceled an event. And so the students at Wilson kind of spontaneously on March 1st of 1968 just walked out, you know, maybe I forgot how many, maybe a couple of thousand students from Wilson just got fed up and just straight walked out. And that kind of put all of the planning they had been going on up to that point, you know, suddenly everybody had to make decisions, you know, should we declare the walkout right now? Should we finish our plans? You know, what should we do? And then while they were, you know, having meetings discussing this, a few days later on March 5th, Garfield walked out just kind of spontaneously in support of the walkout at Wilson. The next day, Garfield and Roosevelt both walked out, right? So it just started, the students themselves, just kind of critical mass, just started saying, fuck it, you know, we're just going to fuck this school, you know, fuck the principal, fuck these teachers. We're just going to roll out and, you know, we're just not going to cooperate with this anymore. And so on March 8th, it was agreed that all of the schools would walk out. And so all four major high schools on the East Side all walked out. And Sal Castro joined them, which actually, you know, even though the principal was threatening him not to, you know, it resulted, we're going to talk about in a minute, him getting arrested. And I think he actually lost his job as a result of it. March 8th, 1968 was pouring rain, which is pretty rare in LA. And usually people in LA are like, if it's raining, they don't even want to go to the corner store. Like they won't even drive nowhere, right? But despite the poor weather, the students, you know, just didn't care. They were just so determined to, you know, to just get, you know, stick it to the man that they, you know, I don't know how many, 10,000 students or something, whatever it was, walked out of all the four major high schools. And they converged on Hazard Park. You guys know where that is? It's on the East Side. It's on Soto, just north of the 10, where kind of up the street from the Ramona Gardens housing project. That's where the community there takes their name. Big Hazard is from that park, Hazard Park. It's right kind of between the projects and County USC Hospital, the hospital complex. So anyways, in the pouring rain, everybody, you know, just converged there pretty much in the mud and, you know, blew off school. And it was this huge rally in opposition to the way that they were being treated by their teachers and principals in the school district. Yeah, things seemed to die down, but on May 31st, The police raided a number of people that they either felt or alleged had been involved in coordinating the walkouts, and charged them all with conspiracy. And we call these people the East LA 13. So the East LA 13 are the people who were charged for the walkouts, for organizing the walkouts. I won't name all of them, but there's a few notable people among them. Some of the leading leading Brown Berets at the time, David Sanchez, Carlos Montes, who's actually a booster for our university today. A lot of these people are still around in the community. A lot of them own a lot of property in the community, so they have money to give to the school. the people who run self-help graphics, right, are kind of in the same circle, which of course has existed since then. Another person, my mentor, Diego Vigil, he was a member of the Brown Berets. He's a professor, retired professor from Irvine. His brother, Richard Vigil, was one of the East LA 13. He was a combat vet from Vietnam, and he was arrested as one of the key organizers. So a number of them were arrested. I think it was like six or seven of them were arrested in the raids. And then the other six, you know, two turned themselves in here and two there. The only one that went on the run for some time was Carlos Montes, who finally turned himself in 1978, almost 10 years after the cases were brought. And other people actually went to trial. Most of them went to trial, I think, in 1970. So we're going to talk a little bit about that in a minute. Now, their trial attorney was a very colorful man named Oscar Acosta. If you're not already familiar with Oscar Acosta, you may be without knowing it. If you have ever watched the movie with Johnny Depp, is that his name? Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. Anybody ever seen that movie? Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. It's about this, it's about Hunter Thompson and his friend who just get fucked up. Like, I don't know how the English language can't even describe what these characters just got trashed, like in, I don't know what it is, two or three days in Vegas. Just drove off to Vegas, ate like, you know, a whole bunch of acid and sniffed a ton of cocaine and slammed heroin and drank and waved guns around at people and each other. And it's just, if you haven't seen that movie, that's like an American cult film. You need to watch that thing. So Hunter Thompson is the Johnny Depp's character, right? And the other actor, I think it's Benicio del Toro, plays the other character, right? The other character is Oscar Acosta, the attorney who represented the East LA 13, right? And later we're going to talk about the sect that Biltmore 6. His behavior in that movie is probably not a hell of a lot different from his behavior in the courtroom. He would wear these like psychedelic colored, rainbow colored suits and shit to court that he had custom made. And he would show up to court frying balls, you know, which especially you can imagine back then, like people just, you know, square people, you know, judges and so forth. Wouldn't know how the hell to deal with someone like that, right? In that state of mind. And he was a real attorney. So he, you know, he was making legal arguments and so forth. But can you imagine, you know, being in an open court and the attorney is dressed in like, you know, plaid rainbow and is just frying balls in front of the whole court, not giving a fuck. He wasn't the only attorney. You know, there was a whole team of attorneys. The National Lawyers Guild got involved, the ACLU got involved. There were a group of, I forgot what the name was, a group of an organization of Latino law students around the Los Angeles region, and they wrote some of the briefs, and you know, so it's kind of a group effort. But Oscar Acosta was the litigator, the trial attorney. His strategy for the case was, instead of to, you know, defend the defendants and to, you know, let the court put them on trial, he put the court on trial. And so let me tell you about the Biltmore Six, which case got tied in. And actually, Carlos Montes was charged in both cases. I think maybe David Sanchez was charged in both cases too. I can't recall. I think a couple of people were charged in both. So the Biltmore Six comes out of a speech that Ronald Reagan gave at the Biltmore Hotel, which is still there. The Biltmore is on, what is it, on 6th and Grand? It's pretty tall, but maybe not by modern standards, a fancy hotel. I don't know if anybody's ever been there. There's a great seafood restaurant right down the street, Water Grill. But anyways, so Reagan was invited to give the keynote speech, if you can get this, for the California Department of Education at a special conference on education for Mexican students. And they invited Reagan to give the keynote speech. As you can imagine, the students were not very happy about this. And so they endeavored to disrupt the speech. As the speech started, someone started a fire on the 10th floor by throwing a couple road flares in a linen closet. Reagan never knew that there was a fire, and the fire was put out, I think, with a fire extinguisher or something. So it's not like they evacuated the building or anything. And when Reagan started speaking, a bunch of the students got up and started heckling him, and the cops ran in and tackled them all and dragged them out. And then after they were dragged out, everybody else in the audience got up and applauded Ronald Reagan for continuing to speech. Classic California history, right? And so 6 people were arrested and charged with some crazy conspiracy charge. They were like facing like 20 years in prison or something, because of, you know, they were saying that the starting of the fire was an act of terrorism. You know, that's basically how they were trying to pitch it. So that case got folded in with the East LA case, and Oscar Acosta was the main attorney for these cases. It came out actually, you know, we talked about last time how the Brown Berets and the US organization were deeply infiltrated by the FBI and by FBI assets. And that's true for the Brown Berets too, right? The El Movimiento was also infiltrated. And of course, we don't know for sure how many and who all were FBI assets, though there are many speculations that continue to this day. But there are a couple that we know for sure. One was an LAPD officer named Fernando Sumaya, and another was an ATF agent named, I got his name here, Eustaquio Frank Martinez. He was generally known as Frank. Both of whom were Brown Beret members and infiltrated the inner circle and were provocateurs. And so many people suspect that Sumaya, along with some other member or members of the Brown Berets who were actually FBI assets, that they're the ones that set the fire and were going to set everybody else up. So that's a, you know, unprovable speculation. We don't have no intel profiles on that, like we do for the Fred Hampton assassination, for example. But that's a speculation. So anyways, Acosta's legal strategy was basically to accuse the court of racism against Mexican, against the defendants on the basis of them being of Mexican descent. Now, their being of Mexican descent was an issue, a legal issue to be, that got worked out. You know, they had to be argued in the case. Because up until that point, you know, in the first half of the 20th century and the post-war years, you know, the 40s and the 50s, and really into the 60s through the radical civil rights movement, Mexican Americans essentially thought of themselves as just that. They checked white on the census every year. They thought of themselves as being white with the rationale that they were the descendants of Spaniards who had come from Spain. And that's why they had Spanish surnames. And that's why their ancestors spoke Spanish, and they didn't, most of them didn't speak Spanish. Many of them didn't. They would intentionally speak English and not teach their kids Spanish. Now, depending on how old you are, you may have people like this in your family if your family has been here for multiple generations. Anybody have, you know, parents or grandparents or great-grandparents whose names were Mike and Bill and, you know, Sarah and, you know, that are not Spanish names or indigenous names, right? Now it's very common for people, for Latinos to have Spanish or indigenous names. But back then, people wanted to assimilate to be white, right? And so legally, even though there had been a long history of racism against people of Mexican American descent, right? There was a dispute as to whether Mexicans were even a race separate from white, and therefore could they even be the victims of racism, right? So this is one of the issues that they litigated. Acosta accused the entire, he basically pointed out that no grand jurors, you know, grand jurors are the ones that are given the case by the district attorney and they decide to file charges, right? That no grand, that no Mexican Americans had, were able to serve on the grand jury, and that there were virtually no Mexican, there were very few Mexican American judges, almost none, no one who had served on a grand jury, and that this was evidence of racism in the legal system. And so who chooses grand jurors? Judges choose them. Judges suggest a few names to be added to the grand jury pool. And so what Oscar Acosta did is he called every judge in the whole state as a witness to for him to interrogate them as to whether they were racists or not, and why they had not appointed anyone who was Mexican-American to the grand jury pool. And in doing this, he had disqualified every judge in the state from serving as a trial judge in the case. So it's a very clever legal strategy, but it also, you know, really disrupted the case. And so that's kind of like the, you know, the legal strategy that they used was to disrupt the case at every stage and to not play into the narrative that the government was trying to build. Eventually, pretty much everyone, no one was convicted. Everyone beat their case at trial, or a number of the cases, the judges who had been so embarrassed throughout the cases because they had to admit that there really was no evidence at all that these people had been involved in any type of conspiracy. And even Carlos Montes, who disappeared for a number of years, when he reappeared, he went to trial in 1978 and he also won a trial. So basically everybody, you know, nobody ended up getting in any real serious trouble over these cases. In 1970, on August 29th of 1970, there was another massive action in East LA that we call the Chicano Moratorium March. It was attended by, estimates are somewhere around 20,000 people, students, you know, high school students, college students, but also people from the community, you know, of course, Brown Berets and so forth. But, you know, what really made the moratorium march special was that it wasn't just kids protesting, right? It was the whole neighborhood came out, right? This is at a time when the population of East Los Angeles, all of East Los Angeles, Boyle Heights, Northeast, everything, was about 100,000 people. So 20,000 people coming out is a big chunk of the neighborhood, right? The march marched along Whittier Boulevard, which of course is still an important, you know, kind of center of East LA, to Laguna Park, as it was called then, known today now you may recognize as Salazar Park. Of course, it was called Laguna Park before because there's a big lake in the middle of it. There was essentially a huge riot, but not a riot of the protesters, a riot of the sheriff's department, mostly and LAPD to a lesser extent, attacking the protesters. The protesters set up in the park, they had like a stage and people were playing music. and giving speeches and passing out pamphlets. And some people were smoking and drinking and chilling, and there were children there and, you know, old people, and, you know, the whole neighborhood was out. And the sheriffs formed a battle line, like they're fucking Romans or something, and charged the crowd and attacked everybody. And in the mayhem that ensued, you know, who knows how many people were injured. People fled and ran back up Whittier Boulevard and so forth. Later that afternoon, around 5 or 6 p.m., a reporter from the Los Angeles Times, Ruben Salazar, who had been, you know, both in print. He was actually the station chief for LA Times in Mexico City for a number of years. And he was on TV news. And so he's probably the most prominent Mexican-American journalist in Los Angeles at the time. Him and a couple of friends decided to get a drink at the Silver Dollar Bar and were followed in there by a sheriff's deputy who fired a projectile missile from a grenade launcher that lodged in Ruben Salazar's skull and killed him. And so the Salazar murder is a, you know, has been a point of contention for residents of East Los Angeles ever since. Needless to say, the officer was not held accountable. There was legal hearings, which you're going to see in the documentary I'm going to play right now. So I'm going to play a documentary about the moratorium march and its aftermath, and you're going to see actual courtroom footage of both people who were organizers, and they even have the cop that fired the round into Ruben Salazar's head. He testifies as well. So you can watch it all and come to your own conclusion. So let me start that up for you here. Let me know. Can you see it and hear it?
Yes.
United States, emblem of the Constitution and of freedom and justice for all. The coroner's inquest of Los Angeles County is now in session. Hearing Officer Norman Pitluck presiding. You see, please come to order. No smoking.
From information received by the coroner's office, we know that the name of the deceased was Ruben Salazar. His date of death, August 29, 1970. A male, a native of Mexico, born on March 3, 1928, and approximately 42 years of age at the time of his death. Katsuyama, I hand you Coroner's Exhibit 1 for identification and ask you whether this is the kind of missile consistent with the decedent's wound.
Yesterday, by measurement, that it's approximately 1.5 inches in diameter.
And what is its general length?
This particular one is approximately 9.5 inches in length. It appears to have several perforations on the side, and at present the blackish material falls out of these perforations. There also are three extensions from the end of the projectile.
And it is your opinion that this is consistent with the wound you found?
A missile or a projectile of this type could have caused the injury.
classroom with little children that were there. They were very scared. They were crying. The mother had never seen such a thing. She didn't know something like that would occur. She thought she would be safe, you know, being that it was made clear that it was going to be a legal and peaceful demonstration. A tear gas pallet went into the restroom, and the children were gassed along with the adults and other people that were there.
Did you observe any police car windows being broken?
Yes, I did.
Will you please describe if you saw, was used to break the police car windows?
Well, many or some of the police car windows were broken by rocks. But again, it wasn't just an indiscriminate breaking of police windows for the sake of breaking police windows. Again, let me repeat that most of the rock throwing that happened was in response to the brutal attack on the part of the police and the part of the sheriffs. That's all the people had.
All right, then, you've told us about rocks. Is there anything else that was used?
Well, I would imagine others...
No, I wouldn't want you to imagine, only something that you saw.
Well, possibly sticks.
You did see sticks used?
Yes.
All right.
Anything that might be there on the ground that people, to protect themselves, might try to use in their defense.
All right. Would you describe the individual you saw throwing the article or articles at police car windows?
Wow.
If you know.
No, that's really impossible.
All right. Do you have any photographs in your collection of individuals who did break police car windows?
No, I don't.
Do you have any photographs in your collection of broken police windows? Police car windows?
I would imagine I do have.
Do you have them with you?
No, I don't.
Did you personally see any windows broken, any stores or shops along Whittier Boulevard?
I saw windows broken on Whittier Boulevard, not at the time that they were being broken. I observed that they were broken, as I passed through Whittier Boulevard.
Do you know of what type of item was used to break the windows? If you know.
No.
Did you see any particular individuals who were breaking windows?
I think I answered that question already.
Well, if the answer is no, I'd appreciate it.
Well, I answered that question already. I told you already before that I...
Well, that was in connection with police windows. This is in connection with store windows.
Well, in connection with store windows, the previous question that you asked me, did I observe any individuals, and I had said no. I told you that I observed windows were already broken when I passed...
All right. Do you have any pictures of any individuals in that connection? Any pictures of anyone breaking a window?
Well, if we follow the logic of the questions that you're asking me. I told you that the windows that I did see were already broken. Of course, how would I be able to see the...
All right. You were going to say something. Would you finish up? I don't want to stop
this
you.
Yes, this is one reason why we get a great deal, we fall under situations where we'd be harassed is simply because... We are a newspaper in the barrio, but we cannot get any newspaperman's identification tags like most of the regular media can, because we are not recognized as a newspaper. Therefore, we are considered many times, in fact, those individuals that, you know, that are, you might say, you know, should not be allowed in an area. And so therefore, we are always under constant threat of attack from the police themselves. Just as last night, we were harassed and chased up two or three blocks from the area of where the police were at. We were simply trying to cover a news story. Another thing, when you were questioning me here on the photographs about the Silver Dollar Cafe, you know, whether you could see looting in and around the area and fire, what have you, when the deputy, or what, I believe the off-duty Monterey policeman was up here, his photographs were very near. I wish you would pay attention.
The jury makes the decision.
So well, it seems to me that you would have to try to follow the line.
Go right ahead. I'm listening.
The deputy that presented those pictures has taken pictures of the area, which is not really that far away from the Silver Dollar Cafe. And all the pictures that he takes or that he has shown is simply of people that purport to be looting. So, you know, I just want to get this straight so that, you know, that originally this line of questioning that went on as far as the, you know, the credibility of my statements to the effect that while here you're only showing, you know, photographs of police and what have you, yet, you know, deputies themselves that have been presented here did exactly the same thing insofar as they were in the same general area, and they seem to only have taken shots of Pitbull supposedly committing a crime.
Now, does a close view of the photograph show a dozen men?
Well, it shows 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
And what were they doing?
Two young men, one completely surrounded. I think I have a picture blown up of it, of this area right here, where you can see that the man's head, the young man's head is between the officer's club and his arms. His head is right here, and it's being pulled back. In a later photograph, you will see that that young man has been raised, and his head is being pulled back. And you can see the officer's arms, and they are making, you know, you can see there's been force applied. And then you can see the officer directly behind this incident, he's laughing. And you see this quite clearly in the photograph.
Now, you show a you're saying 18 shows a club around his neck.
Yes.
Or that he has it in the middle of the club and he's pulling backwards.
That's right.
Are you judging from your own assumptions what the measure of the pull would be on the club?
Well, if you care to bring the later, the photograph that's in sequence and the blown up of this, and you will see it. There is definite pressure being applied here. Just the angle of the arms and the young man's head being placed to his head. You know, you can see that, and in the picture that is blown up, you'll be able to see much more clearly. Also, the picture in which you see the young man already raised up, you can see the actual tension of the deputy's arms, that he is applying pressure.
You're using the measure, though, based on your own...
On my own photographic knowledge of what I see in a photograph.
How close were you to this scene when you photographed it?
This is, again, within a distance of about 15 feet around that.
Would you bring a complete set of your pictures to this session this afternoon?
That is impossible.
Is that because you can't get your hands on them or something?
That's right.
Where are they now?
Most of our negatives, simply because we believe that the sheriffs were going to raid us, since the day before La Raza was published, the sheriffs were all over our office. At that point, in one point, the sheriffs did try to come into our office. And at this point, one of our lawyers stopped the sheriffs from coming into the office and asked them just what they were trying to do. And at this point, the sheriffs retreated back into the squad cars. They questioned some of the people that were outside. They searched some of the people. They searched the cars and what have you. And this was on a half-hour basis at our office. Anybody coming in or going out was stopped. And so therefore, you know, as far as the work that was being done photographically, we could not take that chance of having the the sheriffs come and steal our property. So therefore, you know, it was removed from the area.
Well, and where are the negatives now?
Well, you know, I don't understand, you know, this line of questioning, whether it is from you or whether it is from the prosecutor or whoever, you know, as to what it has to do, you know, with the inquest of Ruben Salazar.
Well,
you know, you did not ask for the negatives of the sheriffs, or questions were not asked for the negatives of any of these people, and now you're putting me through this hassle of trying to find out, you know, what happens with this. What does that have to do with even just the riot itself? Now you're starting to question my integrity. But of course, I know that because I'm a Mexicano, and that is, you know, that's true. When a Mexicano gets up here, there are some basic things that people should understand about the nature of this inquest, the job, the duty of the hearing officer and the district attorney's office there. The hearing officer is supposed to be unbiasedly hearing the position of each individual witness without inferring or inflecting from his chair, you know, a position on his part. The DA's office is also not supposed to be there representing or defending the sheriff's department, but simply also trying to get information as to the conduct or the conduct of officers or the conduct of people, but not necessarily always in the defense of the sheriffs against, for example, the conduct of the people. But what has happened there in the inquest is that the district attorney's office, as is clearly showing on the TV, is that the DA's office is really trying to defend the sheriffs, and the inquest officer has simply allowed this inquest to degenerate. It allowed it simply in this point. First of all, by not allowing or himself questioning to detail the deputies and the witnesses that gave favorable testimony on the actions of the sheriffs, as in contrast, for example, to that question which was done on myself and Jose Razo and even on Enrique and other witnesses that have testified showing the side, for example, of the people. Himself also, just today at the inquest today, a deputy bringing into evidence, and this being accepted as evidence, newspapers, materials that were found at Belvedere Park even 4 or 5 hours before, have absolutely nothing to do with the parade, with the murder of Ruben, or anything of the sort, but allowing this information to be accepted as evidence. Evidence of what, I don't know. As you will remember in the inquest, La Raza was not accepted to be allowed as evidence. Yet they have allowed a lot of other literature that shows a bad reflection, for example, on the people. You know, actually what is happening is that, you know, the inquest officer Pitlock is actually right now red-baiting the community, red-baiting individuals on the stand. If you will remember, for example, one of the questions that was asked, as a matter of fact, the last question that was asked of me was, he pointed to a picture that I had presented in which showed a large congregation of people with various signs, of which some said, Brown is beautiful, Movimiento Estudiantil Chicano de Atzlan, Unity and Pride, and what have you. Yeah, and there was a little sign at the corner that said, Viva Che. This is what, you know, he questioned. And I don't know whether this question came from the DA's office or from himself. But he said,
do you know who these people are in this photograph?
No, they're beautiful Chicanos.
Now, there's a sign over there that says, Viva Che. Can
yes.
you see that sign?
Yes.
What does Che mean?
Well, Che means what you're referring to.
Why don't you use the speaker of
this? Referring to Che, Ernesto Che Guevara, who is a great hero in Latin America and to all Latin people.
Was he Mr. Castro's man?
Who?
Was he Prime Minister Castro's man?
Ernesto Che Guevara fought against oppression in Latin America, and he died fighting oppression. He died fighting oppression, a very similar type of oppression which we, people in the barrios, are suffering daily on the part of police, on the part of educators, on the part of most of the establishment in this society that refers to us as people that have in reality no rights. And I informed in the chair was, you know, a certain Latin American that in the eyes of many people in Latin America was considered as a hero because he fought against oppression of sorts. Yet, this is not the point. The point is that later on he said, well, isn't he one of Fidel's boys? This is his comment. This is the hearing officer's comments to this point, which if I hadn't been so tired, I would have highly criticized him because I believe that at this point he has completely disqualified himself as an officer of that court because by those comments he was red-baiting myself and implying and throwing some sort of a cloud on my testimony. On testimony that has been presented today in the inquest, same type of questioning to the effect of certain literature of some kind has been accepted for no other purpose than to show a bad reflection or to cloud issues which are not at this moment being contested or not contested. And I think that right now, this as of 2 or 3 weeks, as of probably the second day of this inquest has ceased to really function as an investigating body for finding out the facts of Ruben Salazar, and right now they're simply trying to throw some sort of a reflection on the community which is going to deviate itself from the real issue at hand. Who murdered Ruben Salazar?
I made the decision to fire tear gas. When I approached the doorway, I knew I had a tear gas projectile in the weapon. I didn't know whether I had a long-range missile or whether I had a flight right. It really wouldn't make that much difference to me. The reason for using a flight right or a tumbler would be to get inside the location. I didn't feel that maybe a long-range missile would go through the windows or through the walls, but I wanted to get something inside, and I wanted to get it inside quick. At this time, I was still on the east side of the doorway. I was still in a kneeling position. I jumped across the doorway with the weapon at a semi-chest level. I didn't have it at my waist, but I didn't have it up to my arms, at my shoulder. I fired as I went across, aiming in an upward direction. I attempted to aim up towards the ceiling to bounce the projectile to the rear of the bar. Immediately upon firing and going to the west side of the doorway, I reloaded with a duster cartridge. This is not a projectile. I used this, jumping back across and getting as close to the curtain as I could, because I wanted to make sure that there was some gas concentration in the front portion of the bar. Immediately upon firing, I continued across to the east side of the bar. At this point, I was concerned whether people were at the rear of the bar. I immediately ran to the rear of the bar.
And ask you if you are familiar with this weapon. Would you avoid any hands on the area of the opening to the muzzle?
Yes, this is the weapon I had.
In reality, the rights which people think that they have are no longer really there. The rights which they supposedly thought they had, hopefully as a result of this inquest, they will understand that as Chicanos, they really have very few. and they must begin to look to themselves for the strength, for justice among themselves, because there's nobody else that's going to help us, absolutely nobody.
Hey, kind of a treat to see that. That's not publicly available. A friend of mine at Chicano Studies Research Center at UCLA gave me that. So we had a memorial event when it must have been 2015 in the library. They sent up a whole display and we were playing the video there, so students could walk up on the screen and watch it and stuff. So let's talk a little bit about legal violence. First of all, you know, I one thing I want to press on you is that what happened back then still has, you know, vestiges of authority today. The sheriff at the time was a man named Peter Pitches. Anybody recognize the name Pitches from somewhere? He's in Pitches Detention Center, otherwise known as Wayside, one of the largest carceral facilities in the country.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the largest county jail facility we have here in Los Angeles, jail out in Santa Clarita, right, is named after Sheriff Pitches, who was the sheriff at the time. When he was asked about the conduct of deputies that day, which you just witness for yourself on video, he said that there was no misconduct on the part of any deputy involved of that day. And this is the man that our largest county jail facility is named after today, right? So if this is, you know, hint, hint, wink, wink, this has not gone away, right? Who was the LAPD chief at this time? Anybody know? Any LA history buffs out there? Maybe you'll recognize this name too. Chief William Parker. Chief William Parker was famous for giving thin blue line speeches. You guys know what the thin blue line flag is? Right? It's that American flag that's all black and white, except it has a blue line going through the middle. And it's ostensibly for solidarity among law enforcement officers. Actually, it finds its origins around the turn of the century in New York, where a police commissioner gave this speech saying that the thin blue line is the officers who wear the blue uniforms that are standing between the savages and civilized society. And so this was an idea that that appealed to Chief Parker, and he regularly gave speeches reminding the white residents of Los Angeles that if it wasn't for his boys in blue, the thin blue line, that the savages living in South and East Los Angeles would pour into their neighborhoods and, you know, rob and kill and rape them and so on and so forth. In Los Angeles, the thin blue line was actually a street you're probably familiar with called Alameda. Back in the 60s, people of color did not venture east of Alameda. right? Now we think of those neighborhoods east of Alameda, HP, Maywood, Cudahy, Bell Gardens, Downey. We think of those as primarily Mexican-American neighborhoods. You check the census, they're probably 98% Latino, right? But back then, non-white people did not venture east of Alameda. And what would happen to them if they did? Right, there'd be LAPD officers waiting to beat their ass if they didn't have a good explanation for what they were doing in those communities, right? And so legal violence was a very real part and a very regular part of the experience of both Black and Latino people here in Los Angeles and throughout the nation well into the 60s and 70s, if it's, of course it is today, but actually it was much worse back then, right? And part of what made it so bad is that politicians and, you know, law enforcement leaders weren't really trying to hide that this was going on, right? Chief Parker would, in his Thin Blue Line speeches, would refer to the Mexican-American population of Los Angeles as descended from the wild tribes of Mexico, and regularly referred to African-Americans as monkeys. Now, let's go back to the name, Parker. Does that sound familiar? Parker Center, the building that currently houses the LAPD headquarters, is named after this man. That's right. That big shiny building that's across the street from City Hall is called Parker Center, named after rabidly, shamelessly racist police chief William Parker. They ain't changed nothing. They just have it out there just hanging over you, clowning all of us, right? That these major, you know, institutional buildings in our city and county are named after these people even today, right? So Henny Lopez makes this argument and this critique. Oh, and I should talk about the last big case of police violence in the Chicano movement, the Belvedere Park riot, so-called, right? The second moratorium march on January 31st, 1971, thousands of people again came out, marched down Whittier Boulevard this year to Belvedere Park over, you know, a little further on the east side, right, in the unincorporated county. And the police and sheriff's department came out and this time opened fire on the crowd with live rounds. Over 20 people were shot. One person was killed from a shotgun blast, took a full chest of buckshot from a sheriff's deputy. And ironically, even though the police had, you know, basically carried out a massacre, for it's amazing that more people weren't killed, right? Unfortunately, the community blamed it on the protesters. And so that's kind of like a turning point in history where there was the public opinion turned against the activists who were leading these marches. And that was really the last major direct action taken during the Chicano movement. The following year in 1972, the Brown Berets disbanded. There was accusations and people were kicked out and made counter accusations and so on and so forth. So the whole thing kind of fell apart immediately after these events. So let's think about the idea of Chicano identity and look at the critique that Haney Lopez presents. Now the core of this analysis is, you know, the term I use, legal violence. Now legal violence can be, of course, physical violence, like we saw in the video, like many people have experienced. I'm sure many of you, I certainly had. I actually had a civil rights lawsuit against the cops one time because they caught me writing graffiti and broke my wrist on the spot. Probably not the first person that's happened to, and probably not the last, right? So legal violence can be physical violence from the police, right? But it's also the violence of constantly having to defend yourself in court, right? Being arrested on trumped up charges. You know, there's a famous article, a famous idea in criminology. The process is the punishment, right? Law enforcement, when they want to harass somebody, they can go and arrest them and charge them with whatever they want to. And even if they're found innocent, right? Like you look at the conspiracy charges around the East LA and Biltmore 6 cases, you know, the people went through hell for years at a time fighting these cases and you know, facing the possibility of going to prison for decades and so on and so forth. So even if they're not found guilty, the process of going through all of that is a form of violence in itself, right? And it's a form of violence that particularly people of color, Black, Brown, Indigenous people, people of Asian descent in this country are familiar with, right? Both historically and in many cases still today. And Haney Lopez's argument is that the reason that racialized identities, that racial nationalist identities became so popular in the civil rights movement era, right, is as a response to the legal violence that people were experiencing at the hands of the police and the government and the courts and so forth, right? So it was that victimization that was a common experience for people in working class Black and Brown communities that caused them to respond by emphasizing the identities that had been used to demean and degrade them, right? So essentially, the nationalist racial identities that we take for granted today historically were a reaction against the racism of, you know, white supremacist America, basically. Now, this was a significant turning point in American racial history, if you think about it, right? Prior to this point, oppressed people's response to racism was to assert their humanity, not to assert their identity, right? To challenge that there was such a thing as race and that they were somehow different from white Americans, right? And so we see a change during the civil rights movement era where instead of denouncing the race concept, people embraced it, right? And so people responded to legal violence, according to Haney Lopez, by embracing the identities that were at the root of their oppression. Now, there was a generational divide at that time, and still there is a remnant of, right? Probably the pre-civil rights Mexican-American organization that most reflects the kind of old-timey perspective of the assimilationist perspective is LULAC, the League of United Latin American Citizens. And LULAC was formed after World War I mostly by veterans who were intent on emphasizing their identity as patriotic Americans, right? And so this is kind of like the, you know, we call this now the Pocho perspective, right? People who want to be white and want to assimilate to American society, right? They give themselves and their children anglicized names, right? They don't teach their children Spanish. They encourage their children to think of themselves as being Americans rather than Mexicans, right? And so what happened in the civil rights movement, this coalescing, this invention of the Chicano identity is a reaction against that assimilationist perspective, right? Instead of saying that we're going to assimilate to Anglo culture, it's a rejection of Anglo culture and a rejection of Anglos themselves, right? Of everything that has to do with American society, right? And instead an embracing of Chicanismo as an identity. Probably the one of the early groups to reject assimilation prior to the, they're kind of ahead of their time, prior, decades prior to the civil rights movement, were the Pachucos, right? The ancestors of our modern day Cholos, right? And Pachucos were people who basically took on a cultural identity that was in opposition to Anglo expectations, right? During World War II, people were expected to wear fitting suits because material was a supply chain issue as there is today. And so what would Pachucos do? They would wear extra baggy suits that had twice as much material as they needed, right? They would emphasize an identity that was kind of a counterculture to the mainstream conventional American culture that their parents and, you know, people in the community were striving towards. So the Chicano movement was really an invention of an identity in reaction both to legal violence and to Mexican Americans who were assimilating to American culture, right? It was basically a fuck you to America. Now the Chicano identity movement was modeled explicitly after the Black Power movement, right? And particularly after Ron Karenga's variety of Black Power, right? So many people think of, you know, the Brown Berets and the Black Panthers, and, you know, the Brown Berets were the Mexican version of the Black Panthers, right? The Chicano version, kind of the Chicano counterpart to the Black Panthers. But actually, if you think about what you saw in that film and what you read in the Haney Lopez book, the Brown Berets and the Chicano identity movement really have a lot more in common with the US organization and cultural nationalist perspectives of identity, right? So let's think about that for a second. First of all, what was the slogan that they were chanting during the moratorium march? Chicano power, Chicano power. Where did they get that slogan from? What slogan had just been coined by Stokely Carmichael only a year or two earlier? Black power, right? The act of putting a fist in the air, also taken from the Black Power movement, right? Maybe you noticed there was a sign that said, brown is beautiful. Where did they get that from? From black is beautiful, right? So they're watching what Black nationalists are doing and they're imitating it, giving it a brown washing, so to say, right? It's kind of a mirror image of the Black Power movement, right? But with a Chicano twist, right? So another slogan was Viva la Raza, right? Long live the race. Which race? Of course, the Chicano race, right? So these ideas that people have of themselves, the identities that we take for granted, right, were invented during this time. People took on this consciousness of being Chicano and identifying not just with the term, right, but with the idea of being Chicano, which was more or less a carbon copy of the cultural nationalist identity that Karenga was encouraging African Americans to embrace, right? There's actually very explicit acknowledgments of this by activists at the time. At a UMass conference at UCLA in 1968, they stated that their purpose was to strive for power as a group in the manner of militant Negro Black Power groups. So they're explicitly stating that this is what we're modeling our movement and our identity after, right? The Brown Berets also had close relations with Ron Karenga and Stokely Carmichael, both of whom spoke at events that the Brown Berets organized, Right. So there's a direct connection between these Black nationalist, cultural nationalist groups that we talked about last time and the Chicano movement and its, you know, most, prominent group, the Brown Berets. And if you think about the ideology of Chicano nationalism, it's essentially predicated on a similar position that Karenga had, which is an anti-Anglo essentialism. White people are the enemy, right? And this was, as we talked about, this was a primary point of contention between Karenga and the Panthers. The Panthers were willing to work with like-minded white militants and revolutionaries across racial lines. Karenga was not, even though he served as an advisor to Ronald Reagan and the chief of LAPD after the Watts riots. He preached that African-Americans should not cooperate with Anglo-America and that Anglo-Americans were the enemy. And that's essentially the same position that the Brown Berets and the Chicano movement embraced. However, the Chicano movement also has an anti-Blackness to it, right? By embracing a Chicano identity, right, people were not just distancing themselves from whiteness, which their parents and grandparents had claimed for generations, right? But we're also separating themselves from Blackness, right? And let's think about what the conceptual pseudo-historical basis of this ostensibly unique identity is, right? How is it that Chicanos differentiate themselves from African-Americans? Their myth of origin, right, from a nationalist perspective, is that they are the descendants of Aztlan, right? The mythical homeland of the Aztecs, the Mexica, right? Whereas African-Americans were brought to this continent by Europeans in order to serve as a labor population, right? During Black chattel slavery. And so from the Chicano nationalist perspectives, Chicanos have a right to be here on this land because their ancestors are indigenous to this land, right? So race is a function not just of culture, right? Of cultural praxis, but is also a function of place and space. That what makes Chicanos Chicanos, what grants that identity legitimacy is that people who are members of this identity group have a right to this geographical territory because they claim that their ancestors are from it. Right? Now, what are these perspectives that race is dependent on culture and race is dependent on geographical territory? Where do these ideas come from? Who invented these ideas and when? Let's go back a few weeks, 4 or 5 weeks in our lecture on the history of scientific racism. Where did these ideas came from? These ideas came from white supremacists in the 18th and 19th century. Right, the monogenesists and the polygenesists, remember all that? Right, they're the ones that came up with the idea that racial identity, phenotype, how you look, and behavioral aspects, right, cultural praxis, combine in one identity, that there are certain behaviors and cultural practices that are unique and are essentially the property of certain racial identities. This is one of the six core facets of the race concept. So rather than rejecting the race concept, nationalists are embracing the foundation that makes the race concept possible in the first place. Right? It's like a honeypot. Now, in doing so, Chicanos separate themselves and divide themselves from African-Americans with the belief that they are descended from the indigenous people of this part of the world, right? And so they connect themselves to other indigenous people of the Americas, right? Which may, or in many cases, probably is not true, right? Now, we know a lot about, you know, people who lived here because of archaeology and anthropology. We know quite a bit about what who lived in, you know, in North America and in Mesoamerica prior to English or to European colonization, right? And I think we talked about this before. Language families are a good indicator of that, right? We also have archaeological evidence of where these places were. Now, according to the Chicano myth of origin, Aslan is where? Here, where we are, right? Aslan is, according to the Mexica myth of origin, they left Aslan and came to the Valley of Mexico. And presumably Aslan is anywhere north of, basically north of Mexico City, right? Anywhere north of DF, particularly in the American Southwest, right? Now, it is possible that, you know, that the Mexica came from somewhere up here, maybe the Los Angeles region we talked about. The native Tongva people of the Los Angeles region also speak an Udo-Aztecan language. The Uta, the indigenous people of Nevada, Utah, I think all the way up into Montana, also speak an Udo-Aztecan language, as do a number of people throughout, going down through Mesoamerica, right? So given the linguistic, you know, proximity, it's possible that the historical Mexica came from pretty much anywhere from Utah all the way down to, you know, the bottom below Mexico, right? Now, as for Aslan, while Aslan in the minds of Chicano nationalists is this whole territory of northern Mexico and the American Southwest, where the Mexica ostensibly came from, actually, archaeologically, Aslan is a very specific place that Mexican archaeologists have identified, which is in the region of the city of Colima, which is, anybody know where Colima is? It's on the west coast, the Pacific coast of Mexico, just about due west from Mexico City. So it's not north, it's not up here, it's not in Sinaloa, it's not in Chihuahua, it's not in TJ, it's not in Los Angeles, it's not in Vegas, right? It's in Colima. Now, whether the Aztecs came from the area around Colima, or whether they just say they came from Aslan and actually they came from somewhere else, we can never really know, right? But suffice it to say that this idea that there is this wide, huge region of Aslan and every person of modern Mexican descent, that their ancestors, you know, hail from that region, is of course a myth, right? But it's not just any myth, right? It's a myth that gives people who claim a Chicano identity, it gives them a land claim to that entire region, right? Their racial identity is connected with the geographical territory. Chicanos are from Aslan, Africans are from Africa, Chinese are from China, white people are from Europe, and so on and so forth, right? This is the core of the race concept, is it not? Right? So rather than rejecting the race concept, what people are doing is embracing the race concept and thereby perpetuating it, right? The critique is that by embracing nationalist identities, we're not undermining our oppression, we're becoming the instruments of it. Now let's look at some of the critiques from some of our other authors, one of whom we've talked about already extensively last time, but you can hear in his own words, Fred Hampton. Right. From Hampton's, let me bring up the Hampton reading. From Hampton's perspective, as we've talked about, race is a function of capitalism. right? So let's read directly from here. This is from page 2 of your reading, about halfway down. We never negated the fact that there was racism in America, but we said that when you, oh, you know, let me share this with you. So we're right here. We never negated the fact that there was racism in America, but we said that when you, the byproduct, what comes off of racism, that capitalism comes first and next is racism. That when they brought slaves over here, it was to make money. So first the idea came that we want to make some money. Then the slaves came in order to make that money. That means that capitalism had to, through historical fact, racism had to come from capitalism. It had to be capitalism first, and racism was a byproduct of that, right? So he's basically making the same point that we read about in the readings a few weeks ago, right? That racism was invented in order to facilitate capitalism. Now, this is very prescient of him because the things we read hadn't been written in 1968. So he came to this conclusion on his own, just thinking through the logic of it without actually knowing the history, because the history hadn't been written yet at that time, right? But he accurately recognizes that racism is a function of the capitalist system. It would not exist without it. Now, some other points that Hampton made were critiques of the cultural nationalist movement we talked about last time, right? Essentially, his critique is that cultural nationalism is a form of cosplay, and that by dressing up in the garb of people who you have no direct connection to other than an imagined descent, right? Changing your name and so forth, right? Learning Swahili and what have you, practice, you know, celebrating Kwanzaa and all the rest of it, right? Isn't revolutionary, it's reactionary. That by changing your name, by changing your clothes and so on and so forth, you're not changing the material conditions that lead to your oppression. That it's a distraction from the actual material conditions that result in the subjugation of working class people, and changing our names and, you know, wearing, you know, indigenous clothes and so on and so forth isn't going to do anything to address that structural problem. Furthermore, Hampton essentially accused cultural nationalists like Karanga of being chauvinists, right? In that in the Panther Party, women played a very important role within the party, in many cases equal, if not superior to men. And many of the most significant members of the Panther Party were women, right? However, in the US organization, right, if you recall from your reading, women were relegated to an inferior position as a support for men, even to the extreme of practicing polygamy. Right. Hampton also essentially alleges that cultural nationalists like Karanga and his US organization are government agents, that they work for the police. And that's why he keeps calling them pork chops. If you guys have read the reading yet, or when you do, you'll see this. He keeps calling them pork chops. Why does he call them pork chops? A pork chop is a rib off of the pig. And who is the pig? Who are the pigs? Is the police and the power structure, right? So his argument is that people like Karanga are essentially tools of the ruling classes that spread this nationalist ideology as a distraction from the real fight in society, the real revolution that needs to happen, in order to undermine the capitalist system that's ultimately responsible for the oppression that people face. And he says that all you have to do to find out who the real revolutionaries are and who the government agents are is look at who gets arrested, whose offices get raided, who gets murdered, and who does the murdering, right? If you look at that, it's always the Panther offices that are raided by the police and the FBI. It's Panthers who are being arrested. It's Panthers who are being assassinated. Actually, ironic because he gave this speech literally a month before he himself was assassinated by the Chicago Police Department in an FBI orchestrated COINTELPRO assassination operation. Right, we talked about that last time too. So let's look at some of the quotes. Everybody wants to talk about the pork chops. We'll tell you in a minute. The pigs don't want you to get black. They don't want you to win. They don't want you to get no black studies programs. They don't want you to wear dashikis. They don't want you to learn about the motherland and what roots to eat off the ground. They don't want that because as soon as you get that, as soon as you go back to the 11th century culture, you'll be all right. Check the people who went back to 11th century culture. Check the people that are wearing dashikis and boo-boos and think that's going to free them. Check all these people, find out where they're located, find out the addresses of their office, write them a letter and ask them if in the last year, how many times their office has been attacked. And then write any Black Panther Party anywhere in the United States of America, anywhere in Babylon, and ask them how many times the pigs have attacked them. Then when you get your estimation of both of them, then you figure out what the pigs don't like. That's when you figure out what the pigs don't like. We've been attacked 3 times since June. We know what the pigs don't like. We got people running out of the country by the hundreds. We know what the pigs don't like. We've got people, our Minister of Defense is in jail. Our chairman is in jail. Our Minister of Information's in exile. Our treasurer, the first member of the party, is dead. The Deputy Minister of Defense and the Deputy Minister of Information, Apprentice Bunchy Carter, and John Huggins from Southern California, murdered by some pork chops, talking about a BSU program. We know what the pigs don't like. We said nobody would shoot a panther but a pig, because panthers don't pose a threat to anybody but pigs. And if people tell you that panthers pose threats, then ask them what kind of sense it would make, unless it's to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning to feed somebody's son, and then at 3 o'clock in the afternoon to shoot him to what, save a meal? We don't need to do that. What sense does it make for us to open up a free health clinic where the only prerequisite is that you have got to receive free medical care as a prerequisite that you be sick? And we've got students who jiving themselves, running around playing, talking about they doing something for the struggle, and I want to more, what more could you do? Right? What's he saying there? He's saying that the people who are accusing the Panthers, right? Karanga and the US organization, people like that, cultural nationalists, that nobody ever attacks them. The police aren't raiding their offices. The police aren't arresting them. The police aren't running them out of the country. The police aren't assassinating them, right? Why is that? Do we need Inspector Clouseau to figure this out for us? Right? It's very apparent to Fred Hampton why that is, right? People talking about the party co-opted by white folks. That's what that mini fascist Stokely Carmichael said. He's nothing but a jackanapes. As far as I'm concerned, he's a jackanapes because I've been knowing him for years, and that's all he could be if he go around murder math in the Black Panther Party. If we're co-opted by white people, then check the locations of our offices. Our breakfast program, our free health clinic is open up this Sunday at 16th in Springfield. Does everybody know where 16th and Springfield is at? That's not in Winnetka, you understand? That's not in DeKalb, that's in Babylon. That's in the heart of Babylon, brothers and sisters. What's he saying? All of the Black Panther offices, all of the Black Panther programs are where? They're not in the academy, right? They're not in the suburbs. They're in the heart of the Black community, right? We're talking about destroying the system. And they have hang-ups doing that because they're constantly buying property within the system. And it's kind of hard to burn up on Tuesday what you bought last Monday because they're a bunch of unrepentant capitalists. They'll never repent, and they know better. We try to make excuses for them. They'll go through stages, Fred. No, that's not it, because they're much older than we are. I'm 21. We're all young. So stages, they've done went through them already. Ron Karenga has more degrees than a thermometer. That's right. He got more degrees than a thermometer, and he continues to do what he's doing. How do they fool you? Because they pick the leaders they want, and they put those people up there, and they portray them as being your leaders, when in fact, they're leaders of nobody. Right? What's he saying? He's saying that the reason that someone like Ron Karenga is put up on a pedestal, is in the academy, is that he's invited to give speeches all over town and so on and so forth, is because he's a tool of the ruling classes, right? And that the cultural nationalist ideology and identities that he advocates are really a defense of capitalism, right? By distracting people from the material oppression that they experience and instead focusing their attention on these identities, right? Let's see, there was one other. Okay, so here's where he accuses Karenga of being involved in the Bunch Carter assassination. We're going to move as quickly as we possibly can for the people with the questions and answers and the people with the guilt syndrome and the people who have been embarrassed and shamed and disgraced. And we've talked about their leaders like Leroy Jones and Mama Lama Karenga Tang Karenga, a big bald-headed bazoomba as far as we're concerned, and that's what he is. And we think that if he's going to continue wearing dashikis, that he ought to stop wearing pants because he look a lot better in miniskirts. That's all a motherfucking man need in Babylon that ain't got no gun, and that's a miniskirt. Maybe he can trick his way out of something because he definitely not going to shoot his way out of nothing. He won't fight temptation, but he never killed anybody but the Black Panther Party member. The only time he ever had occasion to use a gun was on Apprentice Bunchy Carter, a revolutionary. This brother had more revolutionary poetry for a motherfucker than anybody. Revolutionary culture. John Huggins. The only time they lifted a gun was against these people. Right? What's he saying here? He's saying that people like Ron Karenga and the US organization have only ever used violence. The people that are trying to unite African Americans around a Black nationalist identity have only ever used violence against other Black people. Right? They're directly responsible for the murders of four Black Panther Party leaders in Southern California. Right? Do we need Inspector Clouseau to figure this out? Right? I think Hampton pretty much laid it out, right? So a lot of what he talked about, I think, is also in that documentary you guys watched last week, where they actually interviewed some of the people who were in the Los Angeles Black Panther Party chapter with Alprentice Bunchy Carter. And I think you saw in the video, a lot of them made a similar accusations, right? And then the other person you see in the video who has a whole book, if you're interested in COINTELPRO, was the FBI agent who was on the LA COINTELPRO squad, right? Wesley Swearingen, who also identified US organization members as FBI assets. So that's what Hampton is saying, right? Ironically, a month before he's assassinated by the FBI, he's saying, look, these people who are pushing this cultural nationalism and this wearing dashikis and boo-boos and Swahili and changing your name to some Africanized name and all this stuff, these people are working for the devil, right? These people are assassinating the real revolutionaries in our communities, people like Alprentice Bunchy Carter, John Huggins, Sylvester Bell, all of the people that were assassinated by them, right? They're doing the same thing the police are doing, which is murdering Black Panther Party members, right? So whose side are they on? Any questions about any of that? So this is a contemporary critique from the end of 1968, right? Right as all of this stuff, all of this history that you guys learned about last time is happening, this is literally the last recorded speech we have of Fred Hampton's before he was assassinated, right? And so you can kind of think about this time in American history as a crossroads, right? What if Fred Hampton, Bunchy Carter, John Huggins, and all these other people had not been assassinated? What would our ethnic studies departments look like today if the leaders of the Black Panther Party had denounced cultural nationalism and been allowed to continue denouncing cultural nationalism instead of being assassinated? Them being assassinated erased from the field of discourse the primary critiques of the Black nationalist movement from within the Black community, right? Think about how that affected how history played out and how we think of our own identities today, right? This whole nationalist identity movement that started in the civil rights movement era, right? That culminated in the establishment of ethnic studies departments throughout the university system, right? All of that traces back to someone like Karenga, right? What if Karenga's most vocal critics had survived to be able to call out that turn to cultural nationalism that occurred in the late 60s and early 70s, right? Would we still be attached to the same nationalist identities that we have today, right? It's like one of those Marvel comics, what if, right? And not just what if, think about why were these people assassinated by the federal government? If they're accusing cultural nationalists of being assets of the FBI and they were assassinated by the FBI, does that tend to confirm or disconfirm their accusations? Right? This is the history they're not teaching you. Okay, so let's move to contemporary critiques of identity politics now. So there are quite a bit. I actually have almost all of them cited in my book that's coming out next year. So if you want to find one place where you can find them all to look them all up and read through them all. There's way more than I can assign for this class. I could probably even fill up a full class with just critiques of identity politics. But I've chose for you this article by Adolf Reed that's pretty recent. I think it came out last year, 2020. Socialism and the Argument Against Race Reductionism. I choose this both because of the author. Adolf Reed Jr. is a senior professor at UPenn. He is pretty old. And he was actually personally involved in the civil rights movement as an organizer in the 60s and 70s. He had become, over the last 10 or 20 years, the most prominent critic of racial nationalist identities of what we call today identity politics more generally, right? So let's look at some of his critiques, and then some of the other critiques that have been made by other scholars, by Reed. His son is actually another one. His son's name is Tour Reed. He's a associate professor of history at, I can't remember where he teaches now. I want to say Temple, but I don't think that's it. And there's a whole bunch of people that have written these critiques. So let's start off with the Reed article. The first critique he makes is a response to the allegation of class reductionism. So many people who are, who are heavily invested in identity politics allege that people who are critics of identity politics engage in what they call class reductionism. That is, that they focus exclusively on class and they deny that racism exists. Now, there are people who deny that racism exists. You wrote a paper about them a couple of weeks ago, right? What do we call those people? Conservatives, or racial realists, to be more specific, right? Now, these colorblind racists, these racial realists, right? Is that the same position as someone like Fred Hampton or Haney Lopez's position or Adolf Reed? Are people who are critiquing, right, identity politics from the left essentially the same as people who are critiquing identity politics from the right? What's the difference between these two critiques? Right? People from the right are saying that identity politics is a barrier to assimilation into an American patriot identity, right? A la LULAC. Right, that Mexicans should take American names and so on and so forth. What's the critique of identity politics from the left? Is that identity politics is a barrier not to assimilation, but to solidarity. Are these the same argument? No, right? People on the left who critique identity politics do not deny that racism exists by any means, right? They fully acknowledge reality that, you know, the undeniable reality that racial disparities, as we looked at a couple of weeks ago, pervade every aspect of American life, right? The question is why? Is racism because white people are mean? Are white people biologically disposed to being assholes? Are all white people racists, right? Does being a person of color prevent you from being biased against people on a racial basis? Right? So what he's saying is that this allegation of class reductionism is really a myth, that there is nobody who critiques identity politics that doesn't acknowledge that racism exists. Racism is a material reality, right? The thing is that what they're saying is that racial nationalists are ignoring class differences, right? That they're ignoring the fact that capitalism is at the root cause of racial disparities. That the reason racial disparities exist is in order to divide us into different opposing racial camps, right? If Black and brown people think that white people are mean to them because they're white, then can there ever be solidarity between white people and Black and brown people, right? And as we talked about with Haney Lopez, the embracing of these racial categories doesn't just separate people of color from white people, it also separates people of color from one another, right? In that African Americans and Mexican Americans imagine themselves as having completely different identities, right? Also in opposition to one another. Now, Reed suggests that what would a real solution to our problems look like, right? Redistribution across the board, right? So he argues that if we were to redistribute society's resources equally across everyone, right, then people who are the most disadvantaged now, people of color, would gain the most from an egalitarian distribution of resources in our society, right? And who would benefit somewhat, though less than people of color, would be white working class people, right? And so everyone who's not rich would of course have a better life if resources were redistributed. Remember that wealth stratification video, that short video we watched? If all of those big giant money stacks were redistributed among all of us equally, right, then people who have the least now would have the most to gain, right? That's very different from, say, racial affirmative action, right? Affirmative action on a race basis focuses on alleviating the condition of individual groups without addressing the material position of other groups, right? What Reed is saying is that it should be across the board. Everybody should be brought to parity. And if that happens, then people who are the worst off now will be much better off, and people who were just below the line will only have a little bit of advantage as a result of it, right? We don't need to fix, to come up with solutions that are race specific. The solutions that we need should help everybody, irregardless of race. Now, Reed says that actually identity politics is a class politics. It's the politics of the ruling classes, right? Of the neoliberal bourgeoisie. It's a distraction from the actual material disadvantage that we all share to one degree or another vis-a-vis the ruling classes, right? Remember when we talked about stratification, I think the figure is that, what is it, 2/3 or 3/4 of African Americans have no assets whatsoever, right? But 25% of white Americans also have no assets whatsoever, right? Materially, they're in the same position. They both ain't got shit. Whereas billionaires, I can't even keep track of how much Bezos and Elon Musk are worth these days, right? That's where all the resources are. So if we redistributed those resources to everybody, right, it would advantage everyone. So people who are saying that we shouldn't redistribute those resources to everybody, we should only focus on individual solutions to individual racial groups, right? They're distracting us from the big picture, right? They're dividing us into different camps where we end up arguing over the crumbs that the ruling classes throw us, right? And we end up into different racialized interest groups, right? You see this, a great example is a recent, my wife's family lives in Compton. Anybody live in Compton? There was a very contentious mayoral election in Compton this past year, right? One candidate was Mexican-American and the other was African-American. Should we be opposing each other, like as if we're fighting over control of the state, that it's either good for one of us and bad for the rest of us? What's with this zero-sum game view of politics, right? That is identity politics that makes us think that way, right? By dividing ourselves into these separate camps, we end up fighting each other over crumbs when Elon Musk and Jeff Bezos are blasting off to the fucking moon. Elon Musk gonna colonize Mars before our dumbasses realize that we're all in the same boat, right? So what are the problems with identity politics? What are all the different critiques, right? It undermines class solidarity, right? All of us who are not rich should be forming like Voltron, but instead they got us the brown lion and the black lion and the yellow lion and the red lion, and they're all off running around somewhere by themselves fighting each other instead of forming together like Voltron to take on Godzilla, right? It balkanizes resistance to oppression. We become the instruments of our own oppression when we embrace these nationalist identities and cut ourselves off from one another, right? A perfect example of this in recent memory is, you guys were paying attention to the George Floyd rebellion last year, right? Anybody take part? Did anybody see that while the rebellion was going on all over the country, people are rebelling against police violence because an African-American man was murdered by the police in Minneapolis? There was a contingent of cholos who came out to Whittier Boulevard to stand shoulder and shoulder with the CHP and LA Sheriff's Department in defense of fucking Nike Town. Anybody see that? There's like literal photos out there of these cholos with their lowriders standing with the CHP and the Sheriff's Department right there posing in front of Nike Town. Google that shit. I see people jumping on their phone. Is this for real? Did this really happen? Fuck yeah, it happened. Why on earth would cholos be standing arm in arm with the cops defending Nike Town when the whole country is rioting because of the police murder of a black man? Because they see police murder as a racial issue, right? To them, the police murder of a black man is a Black Lives Matter issue, right? Black Lives Matter has racialized the issue of police violence. Imagine instead if we had a movement against state violence that protested the deaths of every person who was murdered by the police, irregardless of race. There's actually been people who were murdered by the police, and Black Lives Matter activists went to the scene to protest. And when they found out it wasn't a black person, they left and went home. Right? That is why cholos are on Whittier Boulevard, standing side by side with the police, protecting their community from what is the question, right? In their minds, black people, the violence that black people experience from the police and the violence that they experience from the police have no connection, because they see black people only as adversaries and not as, as comrades, right? Where did they get those ideas from? They got them from this history of cultural nationalism. They got them from our university, right? Which is a prime location of the dissemination of cultural nationalist identities and ideology, right? Our university actually had the first Chicano studies department in the nation, right? And one of the first Pan-African studies departments. We now have the only ethnic studies college outside of San Francisco, right? Where are people getting these ideas that their interests are determined by their race, and that people who have the exact same horrible experiences at the hands of police, people who are struggling to make ends meet just like they are somehow have different interests in there because they're of a different race, right? We're teaching this stuff in our university. I mean, I'm not, but there's whole departments of people who are, right? And we're eating it up. Just like Winnie the Pooh in the honeypot, right? Getting stuck in a tree. We have become the instruments of our own oppression by embracing the categories that are used to oppress us in the first place, right? And thereby dividing us, right? That's why the title of my book is Divide and Conquer, because that's what's happened to us, right? Over our lifetimes and our parents' lifetimes, into our grandparents' lifetimes. There was this fork in the road, right, in the civil rights movement, where Fred Hampton and Bunchy Carter and all these people could have survived, and maybe we would have gone a different direction. But because the principal critics of nationalist ideology were assassinated, we ended up going in a very different direction, right? And the reality that we know today is a direct result of that. So is academia, is what you're receiving in this university an education, or is it indoctrination, right? We're being indoctrinated with nationalist identities, just like previous generations were indoctrinated with American patriotism, right? It's just another form of nationalism, right? Now, another problem with identity politics is that it commodifies identity. Identity becomes a form of private property. A good example of this is this so-called cultural appropriation, right? Why do some people get very upset when other people enjoy cultural practices that they believe belong to them? Because they see cultural practices as a form of private property that is owned by people who share their identity and not to be enjoyed by people who don't. Right? Think about that for a second. Why did people get so mad that Rachel Dolezal thinks she's Black? Or any number of other professors who've been outed as thinking that they're some race other than they are. Oh, and by the way, I think I'm Mexican, so you can call up the newspapers right now and tell them. There's this Juanito, he's talking so much shit in his class, and he said he thinks he's Mexican too, that's right. Right? Why do people get so upset about that? Because they think of racial identity and opportunities that are based on racial identities as a form of property, right? A Mexican person should have gotten that job. A Black person should be in that position. Hey, it might not be me, but at least it's somebody that kind of looks like me. Right? I may have no material advantage to them getting a swell job, right? But somehow I feel better about that, right? So it what does it do? It encourages this racial tokenism. There's this 1% of the BIPOC LGBTQ plus community who get these cushy faculty positions and political jobs and end up being the spokesperson that the newspapers talk to every time they want the opinion of Black or brown or whatever LGBTQ people, whatever identity they want the opinion of. They have their go-to people that they, oh, let's ask the Black Lives Matter people what the Black people think. Is that not a racist-ass perspective? Like, who the fuck are these people to speak for all Black people? Like, the leaders of Black Lives Matter ain't even from LA. Only one of them, actually. And she's from the Valley, right? I think one's from the Valley, one's from Redondo, one's from the East Bay, and one's from, I don't know, Palo Alto or something like that. Why are these people the spokespersons for all of Black Los Angeles, right? Did Black people in Los Angeles vote to make them their spokesperson? No, right? The media has these certain people that they rely on to be the official spokesperson of different identity communities. And then the media puts them up on a pedestal. Think back for a second. What did Fred Hampton say about this? What about those people that get put up on a pedestal? Right? Why are these people being put up on a pedestal? Is it because they're part of the leaders of the revolution? Right? No, obviously not, right? Is the billionaire who owns the LA Times gonna put someone in his newspaper? It's not in his interests? Right? Of course not. Do we need Inspector Clouseau to figure this shit out for us? Think about the careerism of people. People make a whole career out of being a racial spokesperson, a position that they've anointed themselves with. Black Lives Matter has collected over $100 million in donations. We don't really know how much because they've been filing to be a nonprofit for the last 5 years, process that takes all of 3 months. So we will, if they were a real nonprofit, then all of their books would be open. But because they're not, we don't know exactly how much money the Black Lives Matter Global Network has collected. And we don't know how it's been spent either, right? And now the most recent leader of Black Lives Matter has resigned. Where's the money? Did any of the victims of police violence in whose name this money was collected, have any of them received the money? How about the people who were out there protesting the police murders of Black men who were injured in those protests or arrested, who faced criminal prosecution? Have the leaders of Black Lives Matter kicked in even a pretty penny on any of those legal cases? Reimburse people for the hospital bills of all the people who got their eyes shot out at protests in the last year? Have any of those seen one dime of the money that Black Lives Matter collected? What is going on here? Can we get Inspector Clouseau to figure this out for us? right? Racial nationalism is a career for many people, right? It's a career in academia. It's a career as an organizer. It's a career as an activist, right? It's an opportunity, it's a hustle, right? And that's exactly what Fred Hampton said a month before he was murdered by the FBI, right? Identity politics substitutes diversity for actual material redistribution. What's the mantra of the modern university and corporation? DEI. Anybody know what that stands for? Diversity, equity, and inclusion. Oh, it sounds so nice, like I just get butterflies just saying it. Right? Does diversity, equity, and inclusion include redistribution of resources? No. Right? What does it amount to is giving 1% of the 1% of people who are actually suffering material oppression a seat at the table, right? Just like Fred Hampton says, you can't burn down on Tuesday the table that you just were awarded a seat on Monday, right? So these race leaders and racial spokespersons whose whole existence is predicated on racial identity, right? That's a career for them. Again, think about Black Lives Matter. Have any of the founders and leaders of Black Lives Matter themselves experienced acute hypercriminalization over the course of their lives? No. Their only experience with criminalization is getting themselves arrested at a protest on purpose, which of course is a very flagrant demonstration of class privilege. Anybody who grew up in the hood does everything they can to avoid getting arrested by the police. If you're going to get yourself arrested by the police on purpose, okay, clearly you don't have the same criminal record that I do. Right? Have any of the leaders of Black Lives Matter themselves experienced police violence? Have any of their children been murdered by the police? No. Right? So the people who are the leaders of this national movement against police violence themselves have not experienced hypercriminalization, have not been incarcerated, are not the family members of actual victims of these police murders. Upon what grounds do they have the right to be spokesperson for the whole country on this issue? What is the only thing that gives them any credibility whatsoever is that they're Black. Think about that for a second, right? They've made themselves the spokespersons for a whole country. Hundreds of thousands of people stormed into the streets to protest state violence. And the people who are speaking for all of these people themselves are not the victims of state violence. Can't we find parents of people who've been murdered by the police to speak for themselves? Do they have their own voice? Right? How about people who've been victims of police violence? Can they speak for themselves? Could we find a leader for this movement among them? Right? Why is it that our movement against state violence has been racialized? Because of racial nationalism, right? That ideology and identities that go along with it divide us and prevent us from resisting state violence, a movement that includes all of us, right? Sad to say, he's probably going to experience state violence at some point too. All right. Any questions? Oh, you know what? Let's think of what an alternative, what would a redistributive solution be, right? Think about, like, for affirmative action. Instead of affirmative action, now we've already talked about stratification and how racial segregation is a fact of life in this country, right? What if instead of affirmative action being on a racial basis, what if we give, let's just think about the university system, right? Awarding people positions in the top universities in our state. What if we awarded those on an affirmative action based on zip code? Right? There wouldn't be any racial basis to it. And zip codes that are underrepresented in our top tier universities, right? People from those zip codes would be accepted on that basis. And so just like Adolf Reed suggested, if we were to even the playing field by zip code, who would benefit from that most? People who live in zip codes that are underrepresented right now, right? So it is possible for us to find policy solutions that aren't based, that aren't predicated on racialized identities, right? Have you ever heard anyone suggest doing affirmative action by zip code? It's always an argument over race, right? The liberals are saying we should have affirmative action by racial identity, and the conservatives are saying that would be racist. Where are the people saying, hey, you know what? There's a solution that doesn't have anything to do with race. Can we try that? Right? Why are those people, why can't I write an op-ed making that argument? Why won't it be published in the New York Times or the LA Times? Right? Because we're being led to the honeypot. Right? That's what these modern nationalist racialized identities that we ascribe to, that's what it is, right? It's a big fat honeypot, and we're all stuck in it. Ooh, I think I'm done. Any questions? Cognitive dissonance, anybody? So let me, somebody asked about my book. The book is coming out next fall with Temple University Press, and the title, you can just look up my name, the title will be Divide and Conquer. What's the subtitle? Race, Gangs, Identity, and Conflict. So you're welcome to check that out when it comes out. Probably be available on Amazon by August or September. So you're welcome to, I appreciate it if you buy it and read it and share it with your friends. It makes a lot of the same arguments that I made here today. So if what I'm saying here appeals to you, and also if you're just interested in these types of critiques, I've got the whole range of literature cited in the book. So you can take that book and then go to the library and get yourself a whole stack of books that make these types of critiques. So I've condensed it all into a one-hour lecture. So I hope you enjoyed it. And if there's no further questions, we'll move on. Oh, the papers. Yes, let's talk about that. Now, I've finally caught up on all... why didn't I turn off the recording? Or no, I'll keep it on in case someone needs to hear about this. It's not like this. So I caught up on all my grading, and it took me a couple of weeks, but I think I'm finally current. Everything that everyone's turned in all the way back to the beginning should be graded at this point. Now, if you still haven't turned in papers 1 through 3, please get them in as soon as you can. I really want to avoid an avalanche of papers in the last week of class. So I actually, even all those late papers I graded the last couple of weeks, I didn't dock anybody a single point for being late, no matter how late they were, right? But I know I've been bluffing this whole semester, but I'm serious this time. If I get papers 1 through 3 in week 15, I will dock you 1 point, simply to punish you for punishing me. Now, paper 4, worst comes to worst, you can turn it out in by the end of week 15, but basically that Friday, what day is that of week 15? Let's look at my calendar here. I guess that's the 10th. I need to have all your papers by the 10th, right? The fifth paper, everything has to be turned in by the 10th in order for me to grade it, because that next week, what is it, the 13th or 14th, I have to turn in the grades. And I'm going to have a whole stack just from, I got 3 classes with over 200 students. So I actually need a few days to like work day and night to get through training them all. So please, 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 if you haven't turned in 1 through 3, turn it in as soon as you possibly can so I can get those graded before I get crushed with the avalanche of late work that everybody's going to come with in the last week. Cool. All right. Any other questions about any of that?
Thank you.
So what's our schedule here? I think next week we're off, right? It's Thanksgiving week next week. Thanksgiving. And then the following week we'll have our 2 weeks on gender. So we'll talk about the history of gender and radical perspectives on gender and queer identity. Cool. All right. See you guys in 2 weeks. I hope you have a lovely holiday and please get your papers in. Salud. Buenas noches. Good night.